Well, hello and welcome. I'm David Hansen, BIEA STEM Chairman, and I'm your host today. At BIEA, our aim is to inspire more young people to study STEM. Our actions affect our planet, and STEM has a critical role to play in dealing with the legacies of the past and in shaping our future. Used wisely, STEM can be a force for good, and it will be needed as we tackle the huge environmental and climate challenges we face. So at BIEA, we run global events and competitions that will capture the imagination of young people who care deeply about the planet. Previous competitions have been about animal extinction and plastic pollution. Today, the awards are for tackling food waste, a project that is one of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. BIEA works in partnership with the China Sung Ching Ling Science and Cultural Center for Young People in Beijing, and is also linked to COP26. COP26 provides a global focus for all interested groups to share a common mission, which is to tackle climate change. We are particularly delighted that Ken O'Flaherty, the UK government's COP26 regional ambassador to Asia Pacific and South Asia, will join us today, and he will speak later. As you know, today is a virtual event. We have an ambitious agenda, and timing will be critical. So I thank you in advance for your understanding, as I try to keep everybody on time. So we're now going to move to the STEM Challenge. The BIEA STEM Autumn Challenge 2021 through 1920 and into 21 now was composting, turning kitchen waste into renewable resources. It was hosted in two countries, China and the UK, and it was a collaboration between the China Sung Ching Ling Science and Cultural Center for Young People and BIEA. Its key aims are to stimulate learning during the lockdown at home and also meet the United Nations Sustainability Development Goals and as part of our wider mission to save our planet. And I'm delighted to say that our first speaker today is Dr. Alex Holmes. She's the Challenge event designer. She's BIEA head of STEM, and she's also our lead judge. And I will now ask Alex to give us an academic summary, if you will. Thank you, Alex, please.
Thank you, David. As you know, I'm Dr. Alex Holmes. I'm head of STEM at BIEA. And I was delighted to be asked to design the Composting Challenge event last year for students to pursue over the last few months to recognise and to reduce the amount of household waste, organic household waste, that we all produced. Now, as you may know, that BIEA events are hugely international in scope, and so slightly different methods of composting were asked for in different countries. In China, the recycling of organic household waste was done using a bokashi box, and this is an anaerobic process and ferments waste into useful compost. In the UK, the projects are ongoing. As students, we asked to recycle their organic waste using traditional composting methods, which is much slower as it's aerobic, uses oxygen, needs a little bit more heat than we've got certainly in the UK at the moment, and takes a far longer period of time than bokashi. As a lead judge, I was also incredibly impressed by the quality of work that was submitted by all students. And I certainly enjoyed the enthusiasm conveyed in the videos. I was impressed by the care taken, not only in just the measurements and the data analysis of waste, but by the good standards of hygiene and health and safety precautions taken. I particularly enjoyed viewing the videos and the photos of the projects and hearing the clearly stated methods and processes involved in both setting up and keeping that fermentation process going, which, as some of you have found out, is not an easy thing to do. There's a great deal of a reflection and evaluation included in both the reports and the video. And when the projects didn't go according to plan, I was especially pleased to hear how students asked for help and support to get the processes activated again. I'm always pleased to be involved with BIE competitions, and I'm delighted to say that in the coming months, we're going to be having many more events and projects like this. So students, their teachers and families can continue to see and share the cultural differences and lifestyle approaches that we've all got to solving environmental and ecological problems. In the meantime, what can I say? Be safe, stay well. Back to you, David.
Our next presentation is from Mr. Zhun Xiao from the China Sung Qingling Science and Cultural Center for Young People. And he's the China Regional Competition Organizer. And he has sent us a recorded message about the project in China. If we can run that video, please.
Dear Mr. Hansen, Dr. Holmes, Mr. Fenton, Mr. O'Flaherty, Dr. Napper, Ms. Bandon, and young friends from China and the UK. Greetings. It is night in China, so good evening for all of you who stay in China. For young friends in the UK, good afternoon. This is Zhao Jun, Office Director and Project Director of China Sung Qingling Science and Culture Center for Young People. It is my pleasure to see everyone here overcoming the time difference and meet together here online to attend the meeting to create a future we want to visit. The year 2020 was unusual. Due to the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic, we could not communicate face-to-face. However, the pandemic has not stopped us from pursuing sustainable development goals. SCLSEC had designed and launched the activity Sustainable Development Youth in Action, turning kitchen waste into treasure. Teenagers across the country responded positively and signed up proactively. 150 families in China, together with the teenagers from the UK, were selected to participate in the Turning Kitchen Waste into Treasure scientific experiment. The activity received sustainable support and great praise from United Nations Development Programme in China and United Nations Volunteers Program in China. By adding values such as hardworking creates beauty and science and technology enable an environmentally friendly life, the activity empowered young people and offered a stage for them to participate and implement SDGs during the epidemic. During the launch ceremony, Mr. Hansen recorded a video and shared it with audiences. Through this video, he introduced STEM concepts and shared his experience and feelings. In particular, he expressed his wish that through turning kitchen waste into treasure, teenagers can master the skills of thinking like a scientist. By this means, they will become fearless no matter what difficulties they will meet in the future. SCLSEC will further develop this idea to be comprehensive practical activity courses and promote them among middle school and elementary school students in Beijing. In 2021, SCLSEC will continue to cooperate with the BIEA in co-organizing the 2021 STEM competition in China. This year, we will focus on enlightening and guiding the youth to use STEM innovation scientific ideas to repack food delivery packages and reduce the use of plastic products, then contribute to climate change and implement SDGs. I sincerely wish the 2021 STEM competition would achieve great success. Look forward to seeing project results from all of you. Best wishes to our Chinese young people. Hopefully, I will be able to see your faces during the final round and witness your talents. SCLSCC will continue conducting research and developing sustainable development courses and making positive explorations for cultivating young people to develop comprehensively with international visions. The Chinese Lunar New Year is coming soon. This year's zodiac is the Ox. I hope everyone who joined today's event will have unstoppable luck. I wish you all happy in the year of Ox.
Thank you for that message. And yes, we all very much hope that in 2021 we will begin to meet again and share ideas together. It is hard. We can't do that. I'm hoping now that we will be able to hear from Li Hanan, who's from Beijing, aged 11. So I'm hoping we should be able to hear from her.
Thank you, Mr. Hansen. Good afternoon, everyone. My Chinese name is Li Hanan and my English name is Hannah. I'm a volunteer from the China Chongqing Science and Culture Center for Young People. I'm very honored to speak at this assembly. Whenever I hear something about the UK, I think of my visit 2 years ago. I visited the British Museum, London Eye, and the University of Cambridge. I also spent a few days in a British primary school, and everyone made me very welcome. I have many happy memories there. Some British students here today are doing the STEM Autumn Challenge together with us. I finished my project at the end of 2020, and here is my video.
Hello, I'm a Chinese girl. My name is Li Hanhan. I'm 11 years old. I took part in a China STEM Autumn Challenge with the purpose to develop an urban composting system to reduce the amount of organic kitchen waste that goes into landfills. First, organic kitchen waste was put into the composer, then left in the sun to dry. The composer is so big that I had not filled it for 3 days. On the fourth day, I went to the fruit store and the boss gave me lots of waste. I was very happy to do this with my cousin. Then we sorted the green and brown waste and supplemented the weight with cookies. I calculated the proper weight of the bokashi and quicklime, which were added to the compost. Next, I stirred the pile over outdoors almost every day. It smelled stale, and the temperature had an upward trend for the first few days. At that time, liquid fertilizer and the cookies disappeared gradually. They decayed well. When the temperature was above 40 degrees, it became smelly. I expect the process will succeed.
Thank you.
Suddenly, the temperature started to decline. The corn bread became visible, yet vaguely. It decayed slowly. The appearance looked not so bad. Perhaps it will be good fertilizer soon. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.
Hannah, thank you for that wonderful presentation and beautifully presented.
Apart from home composting, there are a lot of things we can also do for sustainable development. My family has been doing a few things. First, we are not using single-use chopsticks or plastic takeaway boxes anymore. Second, we are taking public transport for long journeys, and we try to walk as much as possible. I hope this will reduce population from cars and help stopping global warming. Third, we are turning all lights before we leave home, and we use energy-saving lamps, which saves electricity. Fourth, after we wash vegetables or fruits, the wastewater is collected and we use that water to clean the toilet. Finally, I hope teachers and students from the UK will visit us in China. I welcome you to my home city, Beijing. The 2022 Winter Olympics will be held there. I am sure the coronavirus will be defeated by us then. We will have a great time. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Hannah. And again, thank you so much. We're going to, in a moment here, I hope, from Hugh Xingsong, who's from Shenzhen and age 12.
Hello, everyone. My name is Hu Jinsong. Thank you for this opportunity to speak here today. Recently, the phrase development, sustainable development, keeps coming up into the media. I had always thought that it was an extremely abstract concept, which had no relation to my own studies and life. It was not until I joined a volunteer activity that I realized it is actually around us everywhere we go. Last August, I joined the volunteer to create a better community, Youth Sustainable Development Goals online camp organized by China's Songjiang Science and Culture Center for Young People. Every participant, including me, listen to a talk on this topic online first. Then we investigated and visited the offline communities. We discovered problems targeting on SDG 11 and SDG 13, and we tried to solve them. Some groups looked into safety of the community and regulated parking, while others focused on garbage classification, designed a variety of intelligent garbage cans. This activity not only helped us broaden our horizons, but also sparked our imagination and improved our ability to put ideas into action. Look back on this 5-day camp experience. There was an apprehension of talking to strangers, the joy of fun games with my peers, the incentive brain burning of critical thinking, and the joy of seeing the results of our hard work. Sustainable development no longer seemed to be something out of my reach. In September, I continued to participate in a volunteer activity, which was called Sustainable Development Youth in Action, Turning Kitchen Waste into Treasure. In the activity, we needed to collect kitchen waste, sort it according to its composition, and then compost it. After 1 month of practice, I continued to encounter problems, but through access to information online and consulting teachers, I was able to solve them. In terms of process of composting, I personally feel that it is necessary to reduce the generation of waste and to properly classify the garbage. In this way, we can make waste useful and turn kitchen waste into fertilizer, which can be used for planting flowers and trees, creating lovely living spaces, reduce pollution, and answer the call to the climate change action. In the future, I look forward to participating in more kinds of SDGs and SDEM activities. Sustainable development for a better planet and a better tomorrow. Thank you.
And thank you very, very much for such an excellent presentation. We appreciate that. I believe we may now have a video, which is a project summary from China, before we move on to our next speaker.
SDG, there we go.
Environmental sustainability. Making observation records and challenging yourself to think like a true scientist.
我是来自中国农业大学的罗，我谨代表联合国志愿人员组织。
我是 UNDP
的青年项目官高星姐姐，用我们的双手和智慧不断为保护环境贡献力量。三二一，可持续发展青少年在行动，厨余垃圾
doing with the Song Qingling Foundation during lockdown. We are thrilled to see young people from China and the UK with their friends and families turning kitchen waste into compost and taking the message of environmental sustainability to their hearts.
I've been so worried by the amount of shrimp wrapping and unrecyclable plastic wrappers.
虽然这次活动的结果对我来说不是很满意，但是我觉得这个过程很有意义。
Well, that so clearly shows the enthusiasm and the scale of involvement from our student friends in China. It's absolutely wonderful. Our next speaker is BIEA STEM mentor, Thandiwe Banda, and from the Beacon School in Banstead in the UK. And I'm going to hand over to you, Thandi, if I may.
Hi there, I'm Miss Banda and I'm the faculty lead for science at the Beacon School, and basically we coordinate quite a lot of STEM competitions and we've been working with the BIEA for 2 years now. So we did the compost challenge and we rolled it out to all our students. So over 200 students actually participated and it was done all over lockdown. And so we've got a lot of reports and quite a lot of videos as well that we collected. Our project is still ongoing because what we would really like to do is actually roll out our composters into the community. So one of the things that we're going to be doing is working with our PTA and everyone else in the community to make sure that this actually becomes a reality. Okay, so before I hand over to the students that took part in the Autumn Challenge, I just want to talk about last year. So last year we had the winning project for the challenge for last year, and it was basically an amphibious vehicle. And what it did is that it collected plastic from muddy shores. So the team is here from last year. They'll give you a wave at the end. And basically some of the unique things they did was that they put a spectrometer in their design, which could identify different types of plastics. And they had tilt compensated compasses. And it's that ability to think outside the box that I think the BIEA competitions really provide for students. And what we've done is the prize money for that is what's funding all our future projects. And we're sending little packs to students in other years to make sure that STEM is very accessible even during lockdown. Okay, so these are just some of the ranges of designs that we've got for some of the students. So we've got the first design there on your left, and that's actually one that we've made into a prototype. And then we've got some SketchUp designs, and then we've got some graph designs. And so we're going to make sure that we make a range of designs, test them all, and make sure that the best one is the one we roll out to the final stage and roll out to the community as well. Okay, so I've got a couple of students with me, among other students that are also in the audience, but I've got Grace and Alex who are going to talk about briefly about their project. We're going to start with Grace, and she's just going to briefly summarize what they've done and what they're thinking of doing next, and then Alex will follow after that. So Grace, I'm handing over to you.
Hi everyone, I'm Grace and I am from the Beacon School. I was in a team with Izzy, Harry and Louis, and today I'm going to be discussing with you an investigation that we have partaken in to explore the amounts of waste thrown away on a daily scale. So waste management is a process that involves the collection, transportation and recycling or disposal of waste. So our experiment began with placing lists above three separate bins in our house, recycling, non-recycling and food waste. And then throughout the day, every time someone put something in the bin, they would have to write above in the list what they threw in the bin. So when we came back into school, we all combined our results together and we found the most common components in each bin, which were in recycling, were plastics, paper and tin. In non-recycling were polystyrene material and more plastic. And in food waste was orange, banana and pasta. Following this, these results were then put into bar charts and a pie chart and were then weighed by mass. The next part of our investigation was to construct a composter, which is actually still underway, as Miss Bander said. Our research led us to create a composter based around the indoor design, in the sense that as most of our organic waste was food, you can turn kitchen scraps into compost for houseplants and in the garden. But also our composter had to include elements of the continuous composter, as it was enclosed to prevent rodents and also could be changed yearly rather than weekly. In addition, it also filters from the bottom, and the inside factors keep out pests to make sure nothing interferes with the process. We also had to consider materials that were durable, cheap and sustainable, so that every family on a global scale could afford these composters. So as a team, we decided to use materials such as wood and metal. To conclude our experiment as a group, we learned a variety of new skills which we hope to bring into our new experiments to come, such as teamwork, creativity and listening skills. Thank you.
Okay, so Alex is going to speak next. So Alex, handing over to you.
Hello, so I'm Alex, and I'm also from the Beacon School, as you can probably tell. And so I was also in a group of three people like Grace was, but I was in a separate group. And so there was three of us in the group. So it was me, a girl called Bethany, and another girl called Ruby. And what we did was we each separated our waste into recyclable, non-recyclable and organic. And we had three different areas that we could put this rubbish in. And at the end of each week, we would weigh the rubbish so that we could find out how much was in each rubbish. And then we'd report back to each other. And we were able to generate this table, as you can see here. So it says student A, which was me. And so you have the recyclable, which is 110 grams, non-recyclable, 236 grams, and organic, which is 1,298 grams. And clearly here is organic is much greater than the others. And so always with lots of things, there aren't always going to be everything in line with the graph, and there's going to be anomalies. So with student B, which was Bethany, she had actually had more recyclable than organic, but that is an anomaly when we compared with the rest of our class, and most of people in our class had more organic. It just happened that Bethany had a greater amount of recyclable. And with student C, which was Ruby, she also had more organic with 900 compared to the lower 250 and 270 for the recyclable and non-recyclable. And therefore, even with the anomaly with the greater recyclable for Bethany, it still totaled when we combined all of our results to having more for organic. And you can also see this pictured in the graph on the right. So this is another graph. So we decided, as well as having our mass in grams, that we were going to make it into a percentage of the total mass. So what we did was we added up all of the total mass, and then we found out the percentage for the each, the organic, the recyclable, and the non-recyclable. And you can see from the color of the purple that the organic is much, much greater at 55% compared to the recyclable at 30% and the non-recyclable at 15%. And this is really good because obviously if all of the waste is taken to landfill and is not recyclable, or if it's not organic, then obviously it generates lots and lots of methane, which is not good. And composting reduces the impact on land aesthetics as well as pollution. And this therefore reduces the need for chemical fertilizers, which could lead to leaching and, sorry, I cannot pronounce that word. Okay, so when you scale up our data to the UK, which is, the population is estimated to be 66,796,807 in around mid-2019, it can greatly, greatly change the effects of climate change when you adjust the, based on the percentage mass of organic waste. If people are more likely to compost based on this, then a lot of effect is going to happen. And you could also consider the impact of transporting waste to landfills or even to gardening centres, as many gardening centres have methods of composting. And thank you.
Thank you very much. I think the key messages, as we know, and they're the statistics, the scale of food waste in this country and globally is simply enormous. And not only is that wasteful in terms of economic terms, but the impact in terms of methane, as you've said quite rightly, is terrible in terms of global warming. And so it's something that needs to be dealt with. Thandi, is there anything else you want to summarise from the project in the school?
So I think the idea here is, in the UK, what really we would want this project to have an impact on is policy making. And the only way that that can happen is for more schools to take part. So what we would like to do with this is actually work with other schools. So we're just in contact with another school called Freeman's, so that we can collaborate and have more reach. Because if more people are doing this and thinking about building compost bins in their houses, then this would have a lot more impact, especially in lockdown, because we are generating quite a lot of waste because you're at home and eating quite a bit as well. Yeah. So, and then the other thing is, I'd just like to thank both my students and our Chinese counterparts, because some of these competitions and this challenge in particular makes us realize as teachers that we need to do more to make sure that we are enriching our students' science capital as well. And so it's a very good job, well done to all the students that have taken part as well.
Yes, and my thanks to you and to Grace and to Alex. I think that the timing, your desire to spread the project further, the timing couldn't be better. You know, the UK is hosting COP26. And this is a kind of realistic and immediate practical project that young people could engage in and should engage in. We're going to move to our next speaker. Hopefully we have with us Dr. Imogen Napa, marine biologist from University of Plymouth, International Marine Litter Research Unit. And I thank you, Imogen, for joining us. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name's Dr. Imogen Napa, and I'm a marine scientist at the University of Plymouth. And I'm really excited to tell you about some of the research that I've done during my PhD and as a scientist, and best described as a plastic detective. So my presentation is going to show how you guys can also be a plastic detective. And from just catching the last bits of those presentations there, it sounds like you guys are already on the right steps there. So a little bit about me. I'm a marine scientist, and my whole research looks at how plastic is getting into the ocean. So how does it get from us, our clothes, our facial scrubs, our bags, potentially into the rivers and into the oceans that we all know and love? I grew up in a small seaside town called Clevedon, which is near Bristol, which some of you might know. And I used to love going to the beach with my family. And I used to draw in the sand for hours and hours and hours. But when I was younger, I don't remember there being any plastic on the beach. But I go back to the same beaches now, And unfortunately, I see that they're covered in litter. Lots and lots of small bits of plastic covering the whole strand line of the beach. And this is a beach that you can see on the screen here, which is near where I live in Plymouth. At the moment, it's in Cornwall, and this is just after the storms, and I was taking my dog for a walk. I didn't plan to do a beach clean, but we went down there and it was just so polluted. And I'm sure that you guys have all seen litter like this as well, whether that be on the beach or in a town or a city or the countryside. We all know that litter is accumulating in our environment. And unfortunately, plastic is a huge majority of that litter, and it's so durable and it's so persistent, and all of the benefits that make plastic incredible material are actually also the negatives. And that's why we need to look at how it's getting into the ocean and how we can stop it. So to tell you a little bit about my research, like I said, I've been best described as a plastic detective. That's because I look at the sources of plastic and how they're getting into the ocean. So really investigating the different sources. My first research piece, which you can see on the top of the screen, I was looking at plastic in our facial scrubs. I don't know you, but I never considered that there would be plastic in my facial scrub. When you're washing your face, these tiny plastic beads called microbeads can go down the drain, potentially through the sewage treatment works and then into our ocean. Our research found that up to 3 million tiny microbeads could be in one bottle. And on a squirt on your hand, there could be over 10,000. So you're washing your face potentially with 10,000 little bits. They go down the drain, through the sewage treatment works, and then potentially into our oceans, making it a big plastic soup. And it's completely not needed. It's not required because there's natural alternatives instead, such as sugar, salt, oatmeal, anything that's abrasive to get the skin cells off. That's why it's called an exfoliant. So we took this research to government in the UK, and it's used around the world. And it's been really exciting to see that this research has been used to influence legislation banning microbeads in cosmetics because they're completely not needed. So hopefully every time that we buy some cosmetics and facial scrubs, now you'll only find natural products in there instead. The next research piece that I did, if you look at the bottom of the screen, is washing our clothes. I find it quite surprising to know that most of our clothes are made out of plastic. To prove a point, this is actually polyester. So this fleece is completely plastic minus the zip. I'm actually here in my washing machine lab, hopefully you can see it, where I do a lot of washing clothes and to look at how many fibres come off them. And we did some really scary research that shows for an average wash in the UK, which is about 6 kilograms, up to 700,000 fibres can come off our clothes and potentially, like the microbeads, make their way into our ocean. We're now testing different inventions, such as ones that can go into the drum of the washing machine and external filters that can capture the fibres. And we found them to be up to 80% effective. So again, now in talks with government to make legislation seeing whether we can put washing machine filters in washing machines as they're manufactured. So some of our most recent, well, I say recent, a few years ago now, controversial data has been looking at biodegradable bags. And this bag is a biodegradable bag that's been in the ocean for 3 years. So it was the first experiment that I set up and the last experiment of my PhD, 3 years in total. And we tested biodegradable bags in the soil and the sea. And all we did is we left them there and we took regular samples to see if they were disappearing. And they didn't. That's the scary thing. And this is a biodegradable bag that's been in the ocean for 3 years and it's holding my shopping. So we've got bananas in there, we've got cereal, pasta, biscuits. And I don't know about you, but when I hear the word biodegradable, I assume it's going to break down quickly like an apple and completely disappear. But what we're seeing here with these biodegradable plastics is they're not disappearing. So we need to make sure that we're completely understanding what biodegradable and compostable means, because it often means it has to go into an industrial composter that's got specific conditions such as high heat and high moisture that we're not going to get in the natural environment. So it could work in a closed loop environment. So imagine a football stadium where all of the cups could be biodegradable, collected and then go to an industrial composter. But for people like you and me that go shopping and maybe sometimes have to take a biodegradable bag because we forget one, how am I meant to get it to that industrial composter? And what happens if it does make its way into the environment? So that's where we have to keep these discussions going. And we're calling for better standards for how all of these bags are tested so they can be tested in the same way. Some of our most exciting research has been looking at plastics on Mount Everest. So we found plastics all the way at the deep sea. And when I got the opportunity to look at microplastics from Mount Everest, of course I said yes. So truth be told, the closest I went to Mount Everest was actually here in this lab, but it didn't mean getting the samples were any less exciting. And on the screen, you can see the clouds. If you look to the summit, the little mound to the left, that's the highest sample that we took, which is just below the summit, exactly there where the cursor is, of Mount Everest. It's called Everest Balcony. So here's me with the sample from Everest Balcony. We got other samples as well throughout Mount Everest, but this was the highest one we took. So did we find any plastics? We're hoping that we didn't, and unfortunately we did. We actually found plastic in all of the snow samples that we took from Mount Everest. And we found mostly polyester and acrylic, which is typical materials that you'd use to make outdoor gear, such as coats or ropes or tents. So we're predicting that a lot of plastic has come from the climbers that are climbing Mount Everest on a daily basis. And someone recently has actually called Mount Everest the highest dustbin in the world because it's just accumulating all of this plastic and there's nowhere to dispose of it. And often people are disposing larger bits of plastic because they don't want to carry it all the way to the summit. And now we need to start thinking about the smaller pieces that could be coming off our clothes, off our tents, off our ropes, and looking at how we can try and design products like clothes and ropes and tents so that they shed less in the future. But the scary thing about this research is that we found them all the way from the deep sea and now to the tallest mountain on Earth. So now it's your turn to be a plastic detective, and I've shown you exactly how I do my research. None of my research is difficult. It just takes time, asking the right questions, and to investigate a problem that you're passionate about. So now I want you to be curious, ask questions, and investigate, and you can do the research exactly like I have. Thank you very much.
Imogen, thank you so much. Just a couple of thoughts from that. The first one is, and you have shown, and I think we want young people to understand that research can lead to real policy change. You can have a policy impact by being able to demonstrate there's an issue here. And that's critically important. You know, here's the evidence of what is happening. And in the end, that becomes unarguable. So I congratulate you on, you know, the policy changes you're already affecting. So first thought. The second thought is that it would be a mistake to demonize plastic. Plastic in itself, plastic is one of the great inventions. And there are certain things that certain plastics will do that almost no other material will do. The problem is we have not looked at seriously enough until now, and I think we are now looking at it, the legacy of the past. All the material that was unnecessary or does not break down, or when it breaks down causes even more problems, the material you've been looking at. And I think for the future, for the young, our young STEM students here, is developing and looking at the development of modern plastics that actually sit more comfortably with where we want our environment to be. And we'll still serve those functions that no other material will do. But in many parts of our life, there are many alternatives. So I thank you for your presentation and for your inspiration today. It's been a pleasure to have you with us. Thank you. We're going to move now, if we may, to the Autumn Challenge Award. And we have a video, if we can watch that. Thank you so much. So we come to the awards themselves, and hopefully we will have available. I'm going to ask Ms. Wu Ming, Chief Executive Researcher at the China Sung Qingling Foundation, Adrian Fenton of the Senior STEM consultant to the British Council, and Ken O'Flaherty, COP26 Regional Ambassador, to help me make the award presentation for the Chinese students. And the first awards we are going to look at, if you can go to the next slide, are the Best Effort Awards. And the Best Effort Awards are going to go to Zhao Dan Chen, Yao Tong Chang, Hao Ming Zhu, Hao Zheng, Yan Zhu, Zhang, Hu Wen Yao, and Yu Bo Yong Guan. And I want to say well done. Here they are, just coming up on your screen now. And our congratulations to all of you. Well done. It's my pleasure to give these awards to you. So we're going to move to, if he's available, and I think he is, Adrian Fenton. And I'm going to ask Adrian if he will kindly present the third awards. Adrian, please.
Hello, it's great to be with you today. I'm honoured and privileged to be able to award the third awards here. And these are going to, first of all, Jing Song Hu, Jing Tian Chu, and finally, Hang Yu Yang. So a massive congratulations to these three and of course, all those that have participated in the awards. It's been great to see some of the presentations today, and this collaborative work linking the UK with China in this case is the sort of thing that the British Council really promotes. So well done to everyone who's participated, and another successful year. Thank you
very much. Next, we're going to ask Ms. Wu Min, who will present the second awards, please, if she's available.
Thank you, Mr. Hansen. I'm really happy to join you here today and announce our two winners for the second award. They are Wang Wenhao and Lei Hanhan. Congratulations. I'd like to take this opportunity and say a few words. On behalf of my colleagues from China Songqingling Foundation, I would like to extend our deep gratitude to our friends and colleagues from UK and to our students and their very supportive parents, and also to our team from SCLSCC. Thank you all for your support and efforts to make this project a success. I'd also like to say that year 2020 have witnessed changes and challenges around the world. I sincerely hope that this project will be one of the good things that all of us could remember. And for me, it is just heartwarming to think that somewhere far away, there are so many people who are working together to make this world a little better. Thank you. Mr. Hansen, I'm handing over to you.
Thank you. You're very kind. And thank you for being with us today. Much appreciated. Thank you. And now I'm going to ask if we can move. We're going to ask Ken O'Flaherty if he'll present the first award, please. Ken, if you're there, please.
Hello, David, and hello, everyone. It's a pleasure to be with you all today, and it's been great to see so many fantastic examples of young people taking real concrete action to limit waste around the world. I'd like to congratulate our winner, who is Si Ming Li, who is 10 years old and has been volunteering extensively throughout his time, and has a very keen young scientist. So congratulations, Si Ming Li. And I think your experience as a young volunteer and your passion for STEM really shone through your project, and you're definitely going to be an inspiration for many. Thank you again.
And hopefully he may say a few words if he's available, please.
Thank you, sir. I am really honored to receive this award. I just want to say that the whole challenge has been a great experience. I really enjoyed it. It helped me to understand the phrase sustainable development. I mean, we hear it a lot in the news, but now I know what it means. And now, and more importantly, I am more aware of our actions and what we can do as individuals and families to save our planet. I would love to share my project with young people from the UK and see what the UK students do with their kitchen waste. Finally, I want to thank my mom and dad for their support. We had a lot of fun making the compost. So thanks everyone for this amazing award, and I look forward to more STEAM challenges soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us. A real pleasure to have you with us today. So we congratulate all our winners and indeed everybody who took part. The UK Challenge Awards will be later in the year, as we've already said. And now we move to announce the next challenge for BIAA, the BIAA STEM 2021 competition. And we're going to launch that competition. This year's challenge will be Repack to Restore Our World. And I believe we're going to see a video which sets out what the competition is trying to achieve. If you can run that video, please.
Lunch. It's the meal we put the least amount of thought into. Boring sandwiches, quick pot noodles. It's just there to get us from breakfast to dinner without starving. And because we don't think about lunch, we don't think about all the waste we create with it either. Do you want your lunch to help save the planet? Then we want you to help us make a better lunch solution for everyone by entering our global challenge. Repack to Restore the World challenges students under the age of 21 to come up with alternative ways of sustainably packaging lunches for school and the workplace. You can make a real difference in reducing plastic pollution and helping to save the environment. It's free to enter, and you don't need to be a computer genius to apply. Remember, often the best ideas are the simplest and easiest to implement. Join teams from over 45 countries, as the winners will have the chance to showcase their idea to real scientists and industry experts from around the world. Let's continue our efforts to stem the tide of plastic pollution, because there is no Planet B. So, grab your friends and register your interest today by signing up on www.biaacompetition.org.uk. Protecting the environment starts with you. Let's create a future we want to visit.
Thank you so much. So it is 1 o'clock here in the UK, which is lunchtime in the UK. And that competition, the STEM competition 2021 to repack and restore our world, is now live and open and launched. So that's wonderful. Well, I'm now going to ask if I can Ken O'Flaherty to speak to us a little bit longer now from COP26 Regional Ambassador. And he's going to talk about the role of young people and how they can become involved in driving climate change. And so I'm going to hand over to you, Ken, and we're delighted to have you here with us.
Thank you. Thank you again. And welcome. It's clear that we are now at a turning point for our planet and for our health. Climate change, if it's not tackled, will sharply increase global temperatures, and it will make large parts of the Earth uninhabitable. Our oceans will become warmer and less able to sustain life, and extreme weather events such as hurricanes or floods will become much, much more frequent. The consequences for populations worldwide of these changes will be catastrophic. Now, world leaders will come together in Glasgow this November for the so-called COP26 event. The UK government is clear that this must deliver strong climate action to protect our planet, driving down emissions and delivering support to those who are already dealing with the impacts of climate change. COP26 must unite the world on a path to a zero carbon economy as we build back greener from the current COVID-19 pandemic. We know that governments don't have all the answers, and they can't solve this problem on their own. We need an all-of-society approach. Governments, businesses, investors, cities, regions, civil society, young people, indigenous people, and faiths must make net zero commitments and take immediate action to support a green and resilient recovery. Young people are a particularly important voice, and we recognize that young people are calling for urgent action. So we are committed to involving young people in the planning and the hosting of COP26. The voice of young people around the world is a powerful catalyst for change. Young people didn't create our current climate crisis, but the impact of climate change will be most keenly felt by the younger population. We recognize and welcome the exceptional engagement already being made by young people around the world in pressing for urgent action. So the UK COP26 presidency is working in partnership with the Italian government, who will be hosting the pre-COP and a youth event in Milan this year. The youth event will bring together 400 youth delegates to discuss a number of topics with a final declaration submitted to COP26. And the UK government is working hard to ensure a youth voice is represented during our conference preparations and during the event. And it's precisely because young people are central to building climate action that I'm so pleased to be speaking with you today. And it's great to see students from the UK and China working together on these issues. China is a key partner for the UK on our clean growth agenda. China is a world leader on renewables and green technology, and we're keen to partner together. We very much welcomed China's announcement that it will reach net zero emissions by 2060. That will require even faster progress on the energy transition, deploying more renewable energy and moving faster away from coal. The UK has, of course, legislated for net zero by 2050, and we are also a world leader on offshore wind, with plans for a further 40 gigawatts by 2030, or enough to power every single household in the UK. So the UK and China are natural partners, and we have a lot to gain from sharing advice and sharing experience. An important part of the global fight against climate change is action to reduce waste. This can, of course, include the fight against plastics pollution in our rivers and in our oceans. And it also extends to the waste we generate at home. So I was really pleased to learn about your autumn compost challenge, and I warmly congratulate the winners again. I'd also like to welcome the launch of the BIEA STEM competition, which I'm pleased to see continues the sustainability theme. Reducing packaging is essential if we are to reduce plastics pollution and together build a no-waste economy. I very much encourage young people to take part, and I wish everyone who has signed up the very best of luck in the competition. Thank you all for doing what you can to make our daily lives more sustainable in every way. I'm convinced that through personal action and engagement, we can all make a real difference to the future of our planet. I'd encourage everyone listening to identify what more they can do in the days ahead, whether that's reducing use of energy, avoiding petrol car transport, or shopping more sustainably, so that we can all lower our carbon emissions and help limit global warming for our common future. Thank you again.
Thank you so much, Ken, and we look forward to working with you in the future and in being part of the build-up towards COP26. BIA is very keen to be involved with all the young people we know and have within our competition and elsewhere. So some final thoughts from me, if I may. Although 2020 was a challenging year, we still reached 55 countries with our theme, Save Our Shores from Plastic Pollution. And I would wish to thank and congratulate everybody who took part in that competition and also in this composting project. We've set the theme, Repack to Restore the World for 2021. And it's good to know when you listen to Ken and other people that we're not working alone here. And I must say it's wonderful that COP26 is taking place here in the UK this year. I'd wish to thank everybody, all those who have followed the event and the BIEA team who've worked very hard behind the scenes. And now if we can put up a slide, we have some of the many people who help us, and I would wish to thank especially our guests from the British Council, COP26, the Sun Ching Ling Science and Culture Centre for Young People, Plymouth University and the Beacon School. And we should have a slide showing other people who helped us, our media friends at the BBC, BBC World Service, CGTV, China Daily, Shanghai News, the Daily Mail, and many of the supporters. We really thank all of you. As you can see from this list of people. I'm going to let all these play out. So again, our thanks to all our friends and supporters. It's a pleasure working with you. So some final thoughts now. I strongly believe that on so many levels, 2021 is going to be an exciting and an inspiring year. Around the world, we're going to see and achieve great things, and STEM is going to be at the center of that. So I hope you very much enjoy this year. I thank you for supporting us. We have a new competition to become involved with. And now, for all of those who can stay with us for a while, we're going to have a group photo, which will be interesting to see how that works.
3, 2, 1, smile. Hello.
We can all now say goodbye, and we will be back in touch with everybody soon. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you, Alex, for being wonderful there, pulling it all together. Much appreciated. Goodbye, everybody. Bye-bye.